And it's so lovely to see everybody this morning. I want to welcome you to the service of worship as Fresh Start here this morning. We are the people of God gathered in God's presence here this second Sunday of Lent to hear what God has to say to us, to hear what is spoken from our hearts, our deepest selves, to one another and to God, to hold this space with one another and to worship. And so we are so blessed and so privileged to be here. We're blessed and privileged to be with each and every one of you, and especially to hear a good word this morning from Reverend Deanna Wilson, who's familiar to us in Fresh Start. We are so excited, Deanna, to hear your message and to be blessed by your word. So thank you so much for preaching this morning. Friends, let's be in a spirit of prayer together. God of covenant, in the tragedy and the glory of the cross, your Son embraced the power of death and broke its hold over your people. God, may the memory of your mighty acts in Jesus Christ be the watchword of our worship this morning. In this season of repentance, God, we pray that you draw all people to yourself. We pray especially, Lord, that we who are gathered in your name might be drawn closer, ever closer, to your heart, that we might gather into the heart of worship. God, may it be that we who know Jesus as our Lord might put aside the deeds of death and accept the life of your realm. God, especially in this time of worship, we pray that the way of death is set aside forever, and that way of life in your spirit is opened afresh to us. Be with us and abide with us in this time of our worship. Amen. Our first song this morning is the great Canadian songwriter Oscar Peterson's Hymn to Freedom, which is a really wonderful way for us to end Black History Month this month in remembrance of this powerful song. And this song is a blessing to us from our youth pop-up choir. So our youth pop-up choir has prepared a wonderful gift of music this morning, and with the assistance of Emily Parker. So many thanks to them. And so, John, if you would not mind giving us that video. The Hymn to Freedom. Just need to get this sound on that, yeah. Thank you. Absolutely beautiful. I think the choir did a fabulous job for a wonderful, wonderful song. So yeah, I see people applauding. That's very appropriate. They did a fabulous job. Thanks so much. Our scripture this morning is the Gospel according to Mark, chapter 8, verses 27 to 38.
And Sam, by the way, I said I would do the scripture.
Yes, absolutely. I talk to you, Deanna.
You're just setting it up. Okay. I can hardly wait. I'm jumping.
That's good. Yeah, that's just champing at the bit. But fabulous. Yeah.
Okay, now that I have the floor, may I also add to Sam's words to say how pleased I am to be in your midst, to see your loved faces. Can hardly wait to be able to see you up close and personally, but it is such a blessing, isn't it, to be able to meet like this and to have a special place in this morning service to be your speaker. It's been an honor also just for this time to be part of our wonderful worship team. From Donna Lee and Sam and to work along with Hugh and our music director Ian Grundy, it's been a special inspiration and pleasure for me to be part of it for this period of time. So thank you. I'm just going to start with a question. I'm wondering how many of us this morning have brought with us to this time and place someone we love who is suffering. How many we know we love their suffering? I pray especially that this Gospel reading, which many would say is at the heart of the Christian gospel, that this time of sharing God's word will be a particular blessing. Jesus went on with his disciples to the villages of Caesarea Philippi, and on the way, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" They answered him, "John the Baptist," and others say, "Elijah," still others, "one of the prophets." He asked them, "But who do you say that I am?" Peter answered, "You're the Messiah." He sternly ordered them not to tell anyone about him. Then he began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days, rise again. He said all this quite openly. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at his disciples, Jesus rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world, yet forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father and with the holy angels." May God bless the reading of God's holy word. Praise be to you, O Christ. Amen. In the Bible reading, Jesus talks about going on to suffer and to die. We shrink at those words, suffering, death, like Peter did. He had just recently, after all, come to the revelation that Jesus is God's son, the Messiah, the anointed one, the one come to save and bring justice and peace and love and healing to the suffering world. So then, when Jesus rebukes him and says to keep silent, what a terrible blow. Because I hear in Peter's words, behind his proclamation of Jesus as the Christ, I hear Peter say, I love you, Jesus. You can't suffer. I love you. No death, no suffering. I love you. The Russian novelist Dostoevsky has written, to love is to suffer. There can be no love otherwise. We of a certain age know that love and suffering are intertwined. We can sing along with Dionne Warwick. I won't sing it to spare you, but you can sing, I'll never fall in love again. No more lies, no more pain, no more sorrow. Never fall in love again. Love and suffering are intertwined. Peter's protest of love draws us closer into the story because we too shrink from those words, suffering and death. There are many kinds of suffering in our world, of course. We could list them, make our own list. There are the natural disasters of floods and ice storms and fires. There's moral suffering, injustice, hatred, violence, betrayal. There's suffering of the body, of cancer, of Parkinson's, MS. There's many sufferings of the mind and spirit, loneliness, depression, addiction, dementia. There's the suffering of a guilty conscience. There's another kind of suffering, a source of pain, is when we love someone, when we love someone who is suffering. There's an article I read by a Presbyterian minister who has written about his time growing up with his dad's deep depression. He calls the article, What Love Can't Fix. He says, when I was about age 15, my father disappeared. Oh, he showed up. He functioned okay, but he was a gray ghost of his former self. And he says, all my mom and I could do was to tell him we loved him. I love you, Dad. Over and over again, that's all I could do. I thought, how could someone so loved be so sad? Those poignant words, how can love on someone we love suffer so much? Since ancient times, too much suffering, too much pain. People say it's a punishment from God. and have tried to adjust to that understanding of who God is, that many people lose their faith in God, become skeptical of the church and all the trappings of religion. How can a good God, we've heard the question, how can a good God allow God's children to suffer and die, suffer pain and evil? Because think from the 20th century, where there is so much horror, Holocaust, genocide, so much violence and bloodshed in our world. At the same time, we, especially in our Western part of the world, looked to what we could hold on to free us from pain. And amazingly, so many comforts have arisen that we live now and need in order to have such a comfortable life. At the same time as accumulating and seeking this pain-free life by which we would measure how successful we are, at the same time God became less important. We no longer look to God, no longer go to church. We have people in our own family who have distance themselves from God and faith and find their comfort and success in other things. But it means without God, we aren't equipped to deal with suffering. Peter doesn't ask Jesus why he's going on to suffer and to die amidst his protest. There's no why question. Why, if God is so good, would he let his only son, Jesus, go to that terrible suffering and death on a cross? He doesn't ask why. He leaves us to ask the question, but nor does Jesus say why. He only goes on to say that we are to follow him, as though taking up our cross and following him is the equipment we need to deal with suffering and the pain of our living. To get the picture of what this really means, the whole picture, we need to go with Jesus where he is going to Holy Week, to Good Friday, and then to Easter. We need to journey with him to be part of the crowds, celebrating him, but then turning our backs to him, to watch as God watched him suffer the worst of loneliness, abandonment, and agony. Because he was human, God's own son, human, in his suffering, he cries, our human cry, oh God, why have you abandoned me? Then we need to go to Easter. Amongst, just a side note, amongst the world's religions, only our Christian faith understands God so deeply to know how deeply God enters compassionately into our suffering and existence. As Christian followers, we're unique in believing that our God has come in human form, in God's own Son, Jesus Christ, who is one we are to love, who first loves us, and with that love goes to the cross to endure the most terrible sufferings. The poet Isaiah, long before, had prophesied the one who would come, wounded for our transgressions. Upon him was the punishment that makes us whole. By his bruises we are healed. 20th century theologian Bonhoeffer said it to us as well. To suffer is to love. Only a suffering God can help. God's powerful love, we know, because we go 3 days that Jesus said, 3 days he rose again to show us God's powerful love is bigger or stronger than any suffering, than death. Now this time together, we can't explain the mystery of evil and death, the source of so much of our suffering. We can only speak again, God with us, Emmanuel, and of using time to explore the meaning of suffering. But to know God chose not to overwhelm our freedom, because there is an invitation in here as well. God instead joins us in the midst of the evil that we endure and became one of its victims, not eliminating sin or death. They are still present, but taking away its power over us. Jesus suffered and died, I'm repeating myself, suffered and died to enter our frail humanity, to enter our frail existence, to enter our weakness and the places where we are most vulnerable and that is at the center of our suffering. He goes ahead of us, there lifts those things from us with that beam of the cross on which he was hung. And there in that infinite love, broke the power of sin and death over us. He rose again, remember those 3 days, rose again. And no matter how often this world tries to tell us that there is nothing beyond this life and nothing beyond what we do that has any meaning, God says, I love you now and forever, and there is nothing that can get in the way of my love. That writer that I spoke about, he came to know this after much suffering along with his dad, but he says it was therapy, it was medicines, it was a lot of prayer that brought his dad to new ability to relate and to love. And in that time, the writer said, knew what Paul wrote in Romans, that there is nothing in this life that can ever separate us from God's love. So now this is the time we have to choose, and God has given us the freedom to choose. What Jesus invites us to do is pick up our cross. I hope by now you see there's much more meaning in this cross than just what some people say, oh, I have this cross to bear, I have an arthritic knee or a nuisance of a husband or money troubles, cross to bear. Much bigger. We have the opportunity to follow Jesus carrying our cross and to follow him, as this is the equipment we need for whatever suffering we bear in our body or spirit, for the suffering that we know from others, that the suffering that others live with. We have a cross and to follow Jesus. And I think it starts with, or ends with this time, loving Jesus. Fall in love with Jesus as Peter did. Fall in love with Jesus again, maybe for the first time, to follow him who says, I love you. I love you. I will give you my life so that you may have life and abundant life. I love you. Come with me. the Bible tells us so. Amen.
We will move on at this time to our second song, which is, oh, I'm so sorry, I'm losing it. Our second song, which is Euthena, or translated is We Walk His Way, which is a beautiful traditional South African song for Lent, which again is a fitting celebration here at the end of Black History Month. And this one is brought to us by the section leads of our Kingsway Lambton Choir. So John, go ahead, thanks.
Euthena, 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 Euthena,
so thankful as always for this gift of music. Friends, I invite us to be in a spirit of prayer. And so let us pray. Eternal God, you call us to be fruitful servants in your creation and to offer our lives as the foundation of your realm. We lay before you the desires of our hearts that we may be transformed by their fulfillment in your grace. God, we pray for Gracie and for all those who are in physical recovery, therapy, care, medical attention. God, we pray. On the occasion of this Black History Month, Lord, we pray that we may repent of the sin of racism that we commit as individuals and as members of systems. Bless everyone who is oppressed because the world cannot recognize the beauty you have created them with. Lord, especially for members of the Black community in Canada and around the world, we pray. God, we pray for Chloe, for Leanne and Andrew, and all families who live with the blessings and the struggles of newborns and children. God, for all families, we pray. We pray for our leaders in the church, in our city, in our province, our country, and for all those who lead us in all areas of our lives. We pray for wise leadership. Pray. Finally, God, we pray for those who bear the sufferings of the cross in their lives, that you might be present with us even in the moments of greatest pain, because you have been with us through all pain and all suffering. God, we pray. Grant, O God, that the prayers that we offer may be your channel for new and abundant life, not only hoped for, but worked for through faithful word and deed. In Jesus' name, amen. Here at the end of our service, friends, we turn to our time of announcements, and I myself don't have announcements to give, but I want to give some space for the people that do have something to announce.
Just to mention again, Sam, that next Sunday at 11:30 is our annual congregational meeting, and everyone is invited to join us on Zoom for that. The annual report has gone out. Some of you will have received it via email. It's also available online. If you need the written or paper copy, you can contact the office and we'll try and get one out to you before this coming Sunday. And March is Women's History Month. So that's another story of often meaningless suffering. And we recognize as a woman was murdered in a park nearby here in Etobicoke just on Friday, that is very much with us, especially domestic abuse. And when there is suffering without meaning, that's evil. And we bring that suffering with meaning, which we call love, to that place of dignity and meaning, so that we see beyond it. And I thank you so much, Deanna, for your words today and at 10 a.m.
Thank you.
You're here. Well said, Hugh. And yes, at our 10 a.m. service, we are going to be blessed again with Deanna's words. And so thank you so much, Deanna, for pulling double duty. We are the benefactors of that. Absolutely.
Thank you.
Anything else for the good of the cause? I always have loved that phrase. Anything for the good of the cause, friends, that we should.
At our Luke Bible study tomorrow at 10 and 6:45. And if you have been part and you've been away, welcome back at any time. Tomorrow we're going to be looking at the power of Jesus to still the storm.
Oh, what a neat reflection. Thank you so much, Paul. Yes, this has been a blessing for so many of us, that journey through Luke. So thanks so much. Okay, I'm not seeing any other announcements at the moment. So if I might ask you, Deanna, for one more gift for our community, would you bless us as we go?
Now go in peace and love, my dear sisters and brothers in Christ. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship, companionship of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with each of you and all whom you love, and the world that God loves, this day and forevermore. Amen.